La renta fija es uno de los activos que está siendo más comentado en el día de hoy, sobre todo por las políticas de los bancos centrales y esa subida de tipos en Estados Unidos y en Europa. Vamos a ver qué se decide a partir de ahora después del resultado de las elecciones francesas. Vamos a comentar todo este entorno con Bastian Gries, que es jefe de Investment Grade de Oddo. ¿Qué tal? Buenos días. Hi, nice to see you here in Estrategias de Inversión.
Nice to see you.
Lo primero de todo, tenemos dos ritmos en Europa y en Estados Unidos, como he comentado en la introducción. Y empezando por Estados Unidos, ¿cree que el ritmo de subida de tipos se acelerará en los próximos meses?
I would say not really. First of all, we have to consider that the Q1 GDP print in the US was actually relatively weak. It was a sign for seasonal reasons. If you take the Fed meeting last week, I think the market has moved to a pretty high consensus now, above 90% in terms of forecast that we will see a rate hike in June. But apart from that, very strong payroll numbers also, so the unemployment rate in the US is at historically very low levels. Away from that, I think it's going to be a little bit of a wait and see approach, because you have to keep in mind also that the Fed is also targeting the balance sheet. They want to reduce reinvestment of their balance sheet going forward. And we need to keep in mind that also the political uncertainty is still relatively high in the US in terms of the fiscal measures the Trump administration is planning to do over the course of the year. So I think it's much more likely that we will see a continuous gradual approach with, let's say, one or two rate hikes in the second half of this year.
Todo esto a pesar de que la inflación no termina de llegar.
Well, it's picking up slightly, and given the very tight labor market, there is a fair degree of chance that it's going to be ticking up. And what we need to keep in mind in that context is the fact that the Fed has been very explicit that they will also allow for an overshoot of inflation for some time. They have a 2% inflation goal, and they have undershot that goal for quite some time. And Yellen in March has been quite explicit that she could imagine also a period of a little bit higher inflation to make sure that the economy is moving in the right direction. So for the time being, it's not an issue, but yes, inflation could eventually pick up if the economic growth remains stronger.
¿Cómo puede impactar todo esto en un entorno de crecimiento bajo de la economía?
I think overall, I mean, the monetary policy is still highly accommodative. If they move rates now, we move from 1 to 1.25%. It's still historically a very low level. Also, the balance sheet reinvestments are still ongoing. So it's still an environment which is quite accommodative in historical terms. And I think the economy has some room to absorb a little bit tightening of financial policies or monetary policy.
Pasando ya a Europa, ¿dónde hay alternativa en un entorno sabiendo que los tipos de interés no subirán al menos hasta 2019?
Well, I think it's true that for the time being, this Trump reflation trade, which we saw end of last year, has been priced out of the market again in terms of falling rates. But actually in Europe, I do see a chance that we will see some curve steepening again, because we have a fairly good macroeconomic momentum, and that could eventually lead to a reduction in the output gap and a gradual increase in inflation. For the time being, I think the credit market is still a relatively good place to be, because we have a strong fundamental backdrop, earnings are good, and this compression trade and the hunt for yield is still ongoing. And with low default rates, a high yield market, also the crossover segment gives you a fairly good compensation, especially compared to the rates market and the sovereign bond market.
Además, leo que en China puede comprometer el crecimiento económico mundial su ralentización. ¿Lo cree usted así?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, it's obviously a big elephant in the room. I think the recent receding of PMIs is not so concerning yet. We have to acknowledge that after that weakness we saw in Q1 2016, the economy has actually recovered, and maybe also be it for the wrong reason, because it was credit-led again, the growth, and I think it's quite well known that there is a problem in terms of the housing bubble, but it's very, very hard to tell when this will become a major issue, and ultimately we don't know as well whether the authorities will be able to manage that issue going forward. I think what is clear, it's not imminent, and in the near term, China is doing fine and will not impact the world economy adversely. But overall, given the large impact it has on the global growth, if there is a big issue, it will impact sentiment, and via negative feedback loops, it will also impact global growth in a meaningful way, but not right now.
Dentro de los bonos de grado de inversión, ¿en qué sectores están viendo ahora mismo más potencial?
I think given the macroeconomic backdrop right now, we actually like the financial part of the investment grade market, and here also the subordinated debt. You have improving earnings, you have still, especially the European banks, doing the right things for bondholders. They have to de-risk their credit profiles. You have still a very stringent regulation, and a potentially steepening of the yield curve could also benefit profitability. In addition to that, investment grade corporate hybrids do look interesting compared to the high yield market, because here you get a similar yield for very, very solid credit profile. So that's the kind of segment we like in the currently very strong backdrop.
Y si tuviéramos que seleccionar una región, ¿en cuál estáis viendo ahora mismo también más potencial?
Well, we tend to take risk preferably in regions, in the stronger regions, which we like. At the moment, we see the Netherlands, Switzerland, Germany, also even the US as good regions to invest. And here we also don't mind to invest in subordinated bonds. And those bonds exhibit a relatively good risk-reward profile. We are a little bit more cautious on the UK right now, where we find a lot of issuers which we like from a fundamental perspective. But we do not think that the Brexit risk is adequately priced right now. So a little bit of cautiousness here. In the periphery, we take selective risk in Spain, actually, and also even Italy, even though here we see some risk on the horizon from the political end, and there, hence, a little bit more cautiousness compared to Spain.
Ana, y voy a hacerle una última pregunta, y es si contemplan a los mercados emergentes como alternativa de inversión.
And what is true that those markets have a very good momentum at the moment. Also economically, we've seen a rebound in countries like Brazil. Asia is doing fine, and also even when you look at Russia, it's been doing much better than some people feared a few years back. Our mandates are largely focused on the Euro corporate bond market, and hence we use those issuers mainly for diversification purposes and on a very selective basis. But we do have exposure to some of the Mexican issuers right now. In the crossover segment, we like some of the Brazilian names, and in Eastern Europe, we have very selective Russian exposure as well. But it's really, given the structure of our mandates, it's more on a selective basis. But I do have to acknowledge that right now, those markets are performing relatively well, but investors need to keep in mind also that obviously the volatility can be much higher, and the duration, the interest rate risk also tends to be much higher. So there's no free lunch, so to say. If you invest in those bonds, you take on more inherent risk as well.
Pues nos quedamos con todo esto. Muchas gracias por acompañarnos. Ha sido un placer. It has been a pleasure to be with you in this set.
Thank you very much.
Esto ha sido todo. Recuerden que pueden seguir informados de toda la actualidad económica en estrategiasdeinversión.com.